Hello, my name is Steve Winandy, and I'm here with Roddy Erhart, Senior Director of Marketing at Codasip. And we would like to welcome you to the second installment of our video series covering Codasip processors and how to choose the best one for your application. In our first installment, we took a high-level look at Codasip's RISC-V processor portfolio. In the second video, we will discuss processor performance and what you need to consider when picking your Codasip processor. Roddy, in the introductory video, you mentioned that performance means different things to different applications. What should an SoC designer consider with respect to performance?
Well, Steve, you always have to ask yourself, what do you really care about? Is it performance per second? In other words, absolute performance in a particular time. Generally, this will be achieved by using a high clock frequency, with the consequence that you are likely to use a longer pipeline and end up with higher latency. In contrast to that, you may care more about performance per megahertz. In this case, you're wanting to achieve the maximum performance in a given number of clock cycles. A real example of this is low power applications where you have a duty cycle. In other words, your processor goes to sleep and then wakes up and runs an application over a short period. You'll generally want to have a low number of cycles and a low clock frequency for that. So you're likely to use a shorter pipeline and have lower latency. There are obviously other scenarios that you could imagine. The other one, as we mentioned previously, is do you care about integer performance or floating point performance, or if both, what is the mix?
Thanks, Roddy. Can you give a little insight on how SoC designers have qualified performance in the past?
Well, if you go back to the olden days, like when I started doing IC design in the 1980s, we used mini computers in those days, and the manufacturers always spoke in terms of MIPS, millions of instructions per second. However, what is an instruction? There's a big difference between CISC instructions and RISC instructions. They also spoke about megaflops, millions of floating point operations per second. But again, what is an operation? So these measures were rather vague. And there was a desire to have something that was more representative and a better means of comparison. What I remember in those days was the Whetstone benchmark. This was an early synthetic benchmark, and it had about 150 statements, which were mainly floating point operations. However, unlike the idea of an instruction or an operation, Whetstone gave you an objective comparison between different processors. Since then, it's been superseded by more modern alternatives, such as LINPACK.
Interesting. Roddy, there seem to be a lot of synthetic benchmarks available for use. What are the most commonly used ones in practice today and why?
Well, a synthetic benchmark is basically a means of providing meaningful figures simply. There are a number of common characteristics to synthetic benchmarks. Firstly, they need to be relatively small and portable. They also need to represent commonly used relevant applications. They need to be reproducible and transparent and applicable to a range of processors on a fair basis. They also aim to express the benchmark result as a single number. The two most common these days are Drystone and CoreMark. So I'll briefly go into both of these. Drystone was originally developed to complement Whetstone. Whetstone focused on floating point computation, whereas Drystone focused on integer tasks. It's been criticized that string operations were a bit overrepresented, and also some parts of the benchmark may be pre-computed by a compiler. So they may be susceptible to compiler optimization, meaning the benchmark tells you more about how good the compiler is rather than how good the processor is. DMIPS which is more frequently used, means dry stone bits. And this is calculated by dividing a dry stone score by the score of a VAX 11780, which was a 1 MIPS machine. Now, if you're younger than me, you may well not have ever heard of a VAX 11780, but it was a very important mini computer in the 1980s. In fact, I used to run spice simulations on one. DMIPS is a small benchmark that's still popular and generally quoted by IP vendors in DMIPS per megahertz. Unfortunately, there's no standardization of result reporting, meaning that vendors can sometimes be a bit aggressive in what they do, and very often you see things that are not actually allowed by the dry stone benchmark, such as link time optimization. So if you're using DMIPS per megahertz, look carefully at how those results were obtained. Check out the compiler switches. More modern alternative is CoreMark. This was developed by EEMBC in 2009, and it aims to be representative of embedded software. There are four main areas it covers: list processing, including reversing, searching, and sorting; matrix operations, including multiplication and bit extraction; state machine processing; and cyclic redundancy checking. CoreMark avoids values that can be pre-computed at compile time, and commendably has a standardized approach to reporting.
That's a lot of information. How does a designer make sense of all this?
Well, let's end with some tips. Firstly, you need to decide what you really care about. Are you caring about performance per second or per megahertz? If you're looking at absolute performance, then you can't just rely on the per megahertz figure. You need to look and see what the processor is capable of at your target clock frequency. What type of arithmetic are you needing? And again, you need to see if what you're measuring in something like a synthetic benchmark matches that. So synthetic benchmarks can provide useful data simply and quickly, but only if what they're measuring matches what you're really needing. So for example, if you're interested in floating point, don't expect DMIPS per megahertz and CoreMarks per megahertz to tell you very much. Best tests are definitely with your own application code, but if you're going to run tests with your application code, it obviously requires a bigger investment of time than simply checking out synthetic benchmarks.
This concludes our session on processor performance. Please join us for the next video in the series where we look into various aspects of processor complexity. Thank you for watching, and we look forward to seeing you next time.